Funding and moral support for this broadcast is brought to you by the Rodriguez Foundation and from viewers like you. Thank you.
Are there any young folk singers or rock groups you'd recommend for us to hear?
Oh, yeah, there's the Sir Douglas Quintet. I think that's probably the best.
One of my current strong projects is Doug Somm, who I would give the accolade of genius.
Such a groove. Please don't move. Please stay in my love house by the river.
Hey VC, this is Carlos from As the Table Turns. My next spotlight is going to be about band leader and artist Doug Somm. Doug Somm was born and raised in San Antonio, Texas. At the age of five, he was considered a prodigy on the violin, the mandolin, and the steel guitar.
Everybody sang along. We had such a ball in Colorado.
To me, he kind of embodies Texas, you know, what Texas is musically in a way. You know, he's a rocker, he's a blues guy, he could play pedal steel guitar. There's pictures of Doug when he was a little kid, he's like 6 or 7 years old in a cowboy suit playing pedal steel at his dad's honky-tonk in San Antonio.
He, listened to local radio. He also had a tavern or bar or something that was close to him, and he would often hear bands like Bobby Bland. He would hear, I think she said James Brown. There were different groups that would come by, and he could hear the music from his house. He probably snuck over there, I'm sure, too, and snuck a peek, and got a lot of influence from those things, from the radio. He, as a teenager, was offered a continuing spot on the Grand Ole Opry, which is just kind of unheard of. Like, it's a huge honor to be, you know, asked to be a part of the Grand Ole Opry. He could often recite songs, you know, when he was young and play them flawlessly.
Mendocino, Mendocino, when I touch a groove, you know you're mad at the corner.
During his time as a little kid, I think maybe between the age of when he was a teenager and when he was, you know, about 5 years old, he was opening up for, he had like this opening act because he could sing these songs and play these instruments so well. He opened up for Hank Thompson, Farron Young, Hank Williams, Webb Pierce. He met and opened up for, did a little song at the beginning and opened up for Hank Williams. It was Hank Williams' last concert. 2 weeks later, Hank Williams died. He definitely was an amazing artist at a young age, and was only going to get greater from there. In this song, if you can hear it, you can hear, I mean, there's some funk with the horns. You can definitely hear that he has some funk, you know, in what he wants to play. This next song that's going to come on right now, Sell a Song, is going to be something totally different. It's going to be very jazz influenced. I don't know where he heard jazz. You know, I'm sure they had jazz down in San Antonio. But yeah, this is kind of a jazz-based song. And definitely this band, we're listening to the Sir Douglas Quintet. Which was his first big band, but we'll get to that a little later. But anyway, all those guys can play, man. The drummer can play, the bass player can play, you know, the guitarist can play. A very, very tight band. Coming up, he had a little couple bands that he created. I'm forgetting what couple of, the Marques was one of them though. And that band he was opened up for the Clark Five, the Dave Clark Five, I believe. Dave Clark Five. He opened for them, and that's also where he met his longtime friend and eventual bandmate, Augie Myers, because he was also had his own band opening up for that same group. During this time, he kept pestering this disc jockey named the Crazy Cajun. After a while, finally he said yes. Once he said, basically, you got to create a group. And so he created a group with Augie Myers, and they played for him. And he said, all right, well, let's put out some of your music. Think of a name. And they all kind of thought of a name. But I think it was more this Crazy Cajun guy that came up with the Sir Douglas Quintet, and he was kind of trying to exploit the British invasion that was happening at the time, the Beatles, you know, the Rolling Stones, all this stuff that was happening. So he named him the Sir Douglas Quintet because it had that British sound to it, right?
So much about you, he was the man in Houston, and he was the man that could get you on a big label and, you know, and make hits. You know, you think a gangster, mafia type thing, and it was a wilder situation.
Doug had sent him tapes, and he said, send me a hit, I want a hit.
Doug Somm used to drive me nuts. He used to come to the window and drive me crazy, I always wanted to record. I said, boy, I don't know what I'm gonna do with this son of a bitch.
Here, he said, let's get a band, why don't y'all put a band together? Doug called me a couple weeks later, said, man, come out and we'll practice. And I had the only Vox organ in America at that time. And we practiced for a couple of days, and he said, you're right on it, so let's go play.
He was really trying to pick up on something that would hit the British invasion.
So I got an idea. Everything was British, British, British. So we came up with the Sir Douglas Quintet.
Huey Moe made it, put these clown suits on with tails and everything. And we had to call ourselves Sir August, Sir Douglas, Sir Johnny, Sir Frank.
Tonight on Hullabaloo, Chuck Berry, Martha and the Vandellas, the Sir Douglas Quintet.
They didn't have a whole lot of success in San Antonio itself. They had one song, She's About a Mover.
Whoa, yeah, what I say.
That came out, and then they eventually moved from San Antonio to San Francisco, and there they started to get some more success, and got noticed a bit more there, and that's they came out with the song Mendocino, which was a huge hit for them. But it's hard to pin him down to one style, and he, I guess, talked about staying in the groove a lot.
My dad's whole life revolved around the groove.
It was jazz and rock,
rhythm and blues, country and western.
Doug was never satisfied with one thing.
You know where the groove is at, that California thing that don't get it, that far out in space music. Man, play the real thing, man.
But yeah, like I said, he, you know, you can hear some of the songs sound very funk, soul oriented. Some of them sound very jazz based. Some of them sound very country western. Some of them sound Tex-Mex. Some of them sound rock, you know. They sound like a rock and roll song. His influence, you could not pin him down to one style. He is just that diverse and amazing of a player that he could just fit into anything. From the Sir Douglas Quintet, he basically, the band kind of splits, and he goes and does his own thing, and gets a deal with Atlantic Records and Jerry Wexler.
A song now about my hometown.
Where they come out with this album, Doug Somm and the Band. And on here, you know, he's just got so many amazing artists that want to play with him. Bob Dylan wants to play with him. Dr. John. You also have the saxophonist, David Fathead Newman, that played with Ray Charles. Yeah, once again, just like even this song right here that you hear, kind of a country western song, but then almost, I don't know, it just like also has this 70s vibe to it, where it just sounds like a, right there. Anyway, just kind of has this 70s kind of pop, not pop, but, you know, pop rock kind of vibe, you know. When asked in an interview about his style, he was quoted saying this: "I'm part of Willie Nelson's world, and at the same time, I'm part of the Grateful Dead's. I don't ever stay in one bag. I used to play steel guitar with Alvin Crow, and they called me Wayne Douglas. I have all these aliases: Wayne Douglas, Doug Saldana. Saldana is the name that the Mexicans gave me. They said that I had so much Mexican in me that I needed a Mexican name." Yeah, he just is able to mix these styles so well. Doug Somm and the Band is an amazing album. He has another album called Groover's Paradise, which I don't have. One of my friends, he actually just went through his dad's garage, and he found an original of this and of Groover's Paradise. So I was kind of a little bit jealous of that, but they went on tour, and they had a big hit in Scandinavia, actually. Meet Me in Stockholm was the song. And they kind of were able to do a whole tour and have lots of success over in Europe and Scandinavia, not just because of that song, but that was a big part of it, and a big hit for them over there. After their tour in Europe, Doug moved to Canada, to Alberta, Canada, and was there for a little while. And then in 1988, he came back to Texas. But yeah, then from there, he starts seeing the success of the Traveling Wilburys. He kind of talks to his manager and wants to put together a band, and says, "I want to do a Tex-Mex version of the Traveling Wilburys." And so that's where you get the Texas Tornadoes. And there you have him, Augie Myers, Flaco Jimenez, and Freddie Fender. Amazing Tex-Mex band. Voy a cantar estos versos, aunque yo no soy de aquí. Yo soy puro mexicano, soy de San Luis Potosí. Another influence, obviously, that is going to be a big part of Doug Somm's style, and I'm sure he heard it everywhere, was Conjunto music, and all the different styles of Mexican music, you know, coming up from the border, and just there in San Antonio. Flaco Jimenez is kind of one of the progenitors of that Tex-Mex style. Definitely Doug Somm and them as a Texas Tornadoes were just the embodiment of Tex-Mex music, right? So the Texas Tornadoes, they had lots of success, and he was with that band and with the Sir Douglas Quintet and would go off and on, you know, with both of those bands. And then until he finally passed away in New Mexico of a heart attack in his sleep. But Doug Somm, just an amazing artist. Definitely a prodigy, and once again, you could not pigeonhole him in any sort of genre. He just broke out and did whatever he wanted to do, staying in that groove like he always wanted to do. So that is my spotlight on Doug Somm. If you like this, please subscribe, like the video, comment below, and I'll see you guys later. Thanks, VC. Bye.